Hi everybody, this is Byron Jacobs for EverymanChess.com making a short video about our new book which is entitled Study Chess with Matthew Sadler. Now, as you've probably gathered, the author of this book is international grandmaster Matthew Sadler, who, as you may or may not know, more or less quit chess about 12 years ago in the year 2000. He achieved a very high world ranking, getting into the top 20 in the world with a rating well over 2650, but then decided to quit chess to pursue a career in IT. However, a couple of years ago, back in 2010, Matthew decided that he'd want to get back into the chess world in a small way and play a few tournaments, as obviously the urge was still there to play chess. But one thing that he wanted to do very much was not just enter tournaments just for the sake of playing a bit of chess. He wanted to do what we all want to do. He wanted to play chess well. You know, having been one of the top 20 or so players in the world in his previous incarnation as a chess player, he wasn't satisfied to simply shift the pieces around. He wanted to make a good impression. And this book is essentially the product of how Matthew decided he would try and start studying chess again in order to be able to perform at a high level. Now, if you look at the blurb on the back of the book, you'll see that he pretty much overachieved in terms of being able to play a high level again. The first three tournaments he played in, which were one rapid play and two international events, he scored 7 out of 7, 8.5 out of 10, and 8 out of 9. Absolutely staggering scores for someone who has been away from the chess world for so long. Now, Matthew has always been recognised as not only a very fine talent at the game, but also having an incredible ability to tease out the features of the game of chess that are really worthy of study, and to study very hard and to understand exactly what is worth studying in the game. And this book is kind of his distilled thoughts on how you should really go about studying the things that really matter. Now, one thing that's really caught my eye in this book is how Matthew is very, very good at noticing themes that transfer across completely different openings. And I'd like to just show you a few extracts of play that are mentioned in the book so you can see how he identifies this. The first extract I want to flick through quickly is a game Matthew played way back in 1988, where, as you can see with black, he's played the Nydorf variation, and the game continued like this. And here Matthew points out that he's got his eye on the e5 square with this move queen a5, and after the continuation bishop c4, h6, the bishop drops back. Suddenly the point of the queen move out to a5 is revealed, as it supports the advanced g5, which is all about undermining the f4 pawn and allowing black to make use of the e5 square. Now, if we just flick quickly to another game altogether, this is a game where Matthew is black against Mark Hebden from Hastings 1991. This is from a Queen's Gambit, accepted a completely different opening. In this position, white advances in the centre with e4, and Matthew is having his eye on the e5 square, which is very slightly vulnerable once white has made this advance and the capture is coming on d4. And if we see how play continues, we'll see that the knight already comes to e5. It gets driven away, but the weakness doesn't go away. Matthew zeroes in on this weakness very quickly. And in this position, black stands very nicely with a very nice comfortable square on e5 for the knight and a slight weakness on the white king side, and he went on to win the game fairly easily. And the final extract I want to look at is a game that Matthew played from the first tournament from his comeback, if you want to call it that, where he had the black pieces in a kind of rapid play weekend tournament. His opponent opened e4. Matthew, obviously not up on current theory, plays a very strange opening that, you know, you may know that Michael Basman, the English international master, sometimes used to play. But here it's not a terribly successful start for him, and after a few moves, he simply finds himself a pawn down without a great deal of compensation. However, despite the fact that the black position is not that attractive, Matthew immediately understands what he wants to do. He recognises the position basically as being a queen's gambit accepted, but with white having an extra c-pawn. Well, it's not great that your opponent's got an extra pawn, but at least the queen isn't vulnerable to a rook coming to the c-file. And having recognised that this is essentially quite similar to a queen's gambit accepted position, Matthew finds the right plan, with g5 on the king side, fighting basically for control of the e5 square. The game continues a3, g4, knight to d4, and now the knight comes into e5. Now, Matthew's not claiming that black suddenly stands fantastically well, but the point is that he's found the right plan to try and make the most of his position, and white panicked here, and black went on to win fairly quickly. So that's very typical of the kind of stuff that Matthew's talking about in this book. He's talking about how you understand how themes translate across different openings and different types of positions, and although it's important to study, you know, specific openings, middle games and end games, it's also very important to understand how the themes relate across different openings. We think this is an excellent book, and we're sure it's going to do very well, and we hope that you'll want to buy it, and you'll read it, and it will improve your understanding of how to study chess. So that's our new book, Study Chess with Matthew Sadler. It's available in the UK and Europe from August 2012, and in the US from October 2012. This has been Byron Jacobs for EverymanChess.com. Thanks very much for listening.